How Will Dance Music Change? This is from Ransom Note. It's a pretty lengthy article, but there's one bit in it that I want to read to you. So you're gonna see a lot of these op-eds popping up, especially now that we know that we're probably gonna head into about August, I say, until most things are reopened, right? In terms of hitting phase one and two, probably going to be about August, I'll say. So people are now coming to the realization, slowly but surely, that you're not going to probably see another festival in this conventional sense, or a nightclub in this conventional sense, up until next year. There's clubs will not be willing to take that risk of being liable for people, falling ill. And let's say, worst comes to worst, touch wood, someone ends up dying. No one wants that on their conscience at all. That's not a thing. So expect to see nightclubs and that stuff back again next year. So with that, it comes to you need to start thinking about how you're going to approach things and what your kind of goal is when you're going out, what your kind of idea is about how you put together a label, how to put together a party series, maybe how you promote yourself as an artist regardless. But just how everyone operates on the scene is going to be something that we're going to see a lot of changing, mostly because it's going to be enforced. There's going to be no other option. I don't necessarily think a lot of people are going to do it out of the kindness of their hearts, right? I think someone mentioned it before in this article that we're going to see some bigger DJs doing tours in smaller markets and calling it a back to my roots thing, which is, a bit cynical, but we're gonna see that happening. It's not gonna be done for the kindness of heart. It's gonna be done because they don't have any other gigs coming in. But I don't necessarily think that's a bad thing. I think it's gonna be we're gonna reach a point where we're gonna be working in unison a bit more and realizing that we all kind of add different pieces to one big pie. We're all kind of in the same thing together. We're operating different areas, different fan bases, but there's enough money, enough opportunities to go around. We just need to make a better way of kind of segmenting the audiences and the arenas so that there's no kind of unnecessary overlap, and so that allows each scene to build itself up in a really concrete and solid way, I would say anyway, because I don't believe in the idea of like saying, oh, this scene's bad, this one's good. Everything's got its benefits, just depends on where you fall. So this is from Ransom Note. It's titled Influencers, Fees and the Future: How Will Dance Music Change as a Result of the Pandemic? There's a question here at the end I thought was really interesting that I wanted to speak upon. Let's just scroll down the picture. So I think they interview about four or five people on here, and then each question they sort of answer it. But again, like I said, the question here at the end is one I wanted to talk about. It's a bit long, so I'll just quickly go through it. Boop, boop, boop. So it says here, what positive changes can you see the lockdown bringing to nightclubs and DJ scene? And this is from who answers this one? This is Johnny Wilkes. He says the following: surely nobody wants to go back to being exactly the same. I hope not. Maybe there'll be a chance for individual city scenes to thrive because of the travel restrictions. That's part of youth culture that's always intrigued me, how details in the club music and art fashion can be very specific to a certain city. It's hard to predict any of this. I'm winging it, but whatever happens, I hope we see much less prospective club culture. Maybe we'll realize that when we're all together, when we're all gathered together to dance, what we have is precious, which I definitely agree with. I think that's one of the main, my kind of main the bothers or annoyances when I went to Nicaragua for the first time, did a bit of traveling in Central America. And I remember that's one thing that bummed me out when I went to the local clubs there, hearing them banging, every sort of like Drake track that we listen to here in the UK. They were kind of spinning that too at Nicaragua, and you would have liked them. I would have preferred to hear their local DJs playing music that they actually bang week in, week out, because I know that's not what they're listening to when they go back to their rooms or when they're outside, talking in little circles, huddled up dancing. I know that's what they're not listening to. Maybe again, back then, reggaeton wasn't as big as it is now, but I would have preferred to hear a bit stuff that was a bit more site specific. But again, maybe that because I was in the touristy area, you never know. But I hope going forward that we do see a lot more local scenes popping up. So if you do go to like a club in Dortmund, you see like a different vibe feel than you would see if you went to somewhere like Stuttgart. That would be nice to see, right? Because I guess the reason why that happened because they had to cultivate a local scene because there was no way of getting people in and out, flying people in and out because of the restrictions on travel, and because some places might be a little bit tight in terms of how they allow people to travel for business and work and shit. That'd be good going forward. The next one is from Juan McLean, or Juan McLean, I've got how you pronounce it. He says the following. He says, there's so much talk right now about other DJs, lots of finger pointing about who is in it for the right reasons or not. But I think this is just people spinning their wheels, anxiously sitting at home on social media all day. I actually have never met a DJ who I thought was in it for the wrong reasons, like strictly for money. Even top tier DJs who I'm friends with and who I know more than a few, they still love the music, playing for music. And as far as I can tell, for sure, many of them have lost touch with what it's like to struggle financially and embarked bit by bit on the lifestyle changes that make them appear like assholes, like flying in private jets or having absurd house hospitality riders, or just generally presenting a way of living on social media that's far out of reach for the rest of us, which I think is something that I think you could prescribe to everybody. I think we all went through a bit of a malaise. I'm not really for the whole like, hey man, the mother earth is kicking us in the ass and reminding us to like slow down, man. I'm not for that whole hippie shit, but there is something in that, in that there was maybe a bit of a, we did maybe take things for granted. We thought we were invincible, right? We had that kind of like young man courage, where you kind of think the world is kind of there to serve your needs. Nothing can ever conspire against you. You are immortal, you are undefeated. And then, you know, once you get a bit older, you end up getting a bit more cranky and a bit more realistic with things. But I think we did take things for granted. I don't think we appreciate what we had, and maybe this kind of enforced break will make us kind of realize, you know what, things are bad, things are just not what they need to be. But all things considered, it's pretty sick. The fact that you got the ability to put on a night anywhere you want for the most part, get cheap equipment, you know, if you've got a good crew, a good community of artists you can kind of call and kind of get involved in with, you can kind of take part in scenes, you can travel for peanuts around Europe, maybe not in England, you know, the train fees are still a bit expensive, but there's things that you can do that are right at your fingertips that people should be doing more of, but they weren't. So maybe that would kind of, you know, spur people on. And I think for the bigger guys, yeah, there was a bit of, you know, there's a bit of phoning it in. You feel as if some of the top tier guys, especially it feels like once you've hit like RA list, once you've got a couple tunes features on Mixed Mag or DJ Mag, you've basically been set for life, right? If you get featured on Beatport and, you know, when your tune sells out and you're still making stuff and you're still touring actively and you don't mind, you know, the grueling schedules, you're basically set for life. You don't have to really do anything. You can just ride off the success of your one tune that dropped in 2008. And I guess for some of those top tier people, you know, you get to a point where, you know, 5 grand DJ gigs just turn into whatever. You just go there with your pre-made playlist and just play it from track 1 to 20 and just roll out, collect your check and keep it bouncing. So this probably might, you know, get them put a fire up their butt so that they go back into it and start appreciating just how high of a level they are. You never know. Maybe not, maybe he does. It continues here. It says, I think that world will always exist. I've never really cared much about it, me too, because it has not much of anything to do with me. I believe that the world will reemerge different, but the real positive changes I hope and believe will occur in the scenes I occupy. It will simply be a renewed appreciation for being in a club, what are other people, and having transformational experiences. I look forward to being in the local resident again, which is awesome. Because we can't bring in our out-of-town DJs, who knows how long, the idea of playing regularly in the same space to essentially the same crowd with a regularity is exciting. For me, there will always be a huge emphasis on set preparation, making sure there's something new and fresh to present to people, and a massive consideration for experience of others. There will always be consideration for me before, but they seem vital now. Consequently, I think there will be an overwhelming feeling of gratitude and community from all of us within, from all of us meeting together on the dance floor. It is almost overwhelming to imagine what the vibe will be like for the first parties. I think we know what it's going to be like. It's just going to be an absolute horror show. People are going to be falling all over themselves. People are going to be yacked out of their minds, smashed out of their minds. It's not going to be pretty, the first couple of ones, right? First couple of weeks. And then it will get to a point where it will kind of even itself out again, which will be great to see. It'll be nice to see the return to maybe midweek parties, right? For the older folk or the more mature crowd who don't mind going, listen to someone play and just going home. Sort of like a gig, right? Because that used to be a thing back in the day, I'd say early 2000s, where you'd go to a club somewhere and see a live performance by someone that you like on a Wednesday or a Tuesday, get to hear them play for 4 to 5 hours, maybe have a couple of beers and just go home, like a gig. But they stopped doing that sort of stuff, maybe because they were not getting the turnout they wanted, or the artists themselves, it's hard to kind of justify flying somebody in for a Monday Tuesday gig. I don't know, but that would be pretty cool to see. But I don't envision it being, you know, Burning Man or anything, people being communal and helping each other out and, you know, making sure, well, they will be there helping each other out, but I don't think there'll be a lot of responsible drug taking or drinking, I don't think. If you think that's going to happen, then don't get your hopes up. People are going to go off the deep end just because they can. And, you know, you can't really blame them for doing so, actually. It continues here. What's this? Alinko, skip that one. Posthuman says the following: I predict the winter of love. The scene that will replace this will be less dedicated by influential booking agencies and ticketing websites. These bubbles will burst. Techno Twitter will no doubt keep shouting, but DJs won't be playing. It'll open the doors for an entirely new generation, a lot more collaboration and cooperation, especially in the physical world of record shops and venues. I hope to be part of it, but I do not have any expectation of entitlement, which I like. It's a good sentiment. I think you're going to see a lot of that. There'll be maybe a renewed appreciation for record stores, people going out there and shopping again. I tend not to go to them anymore. I probably go only for their little in-store events when someone drops an EP or you go and see someone play. That's usually quite fun, but in terms of actually buying physical records, I don't, because I don't actually spin them. But there maybe is a, maybe I get to a point where I just buy records for the sake of it, just so I can support the artist, because, you know, downloading an album for like 99p versus buying a record, I'm assuming they're going to get a bigger percentage or slice out of the sale of a vinyl than they would do an MP3. That would be cool. And just generally having it in your collection, I think it's quite nice too. Having like a separate vinyl collection that doesn't actively mirror your collection that you have on USB, that's a good option. But yeah, I'm interested to see how that goes and how that happens. Maybe we see new shops popping up with that kind of heart, because that was a concept that was really big in the UK, but a lot of them have kind of closed down over these. I'm not too sure why, because we do get a pretty decent turnout for these in-store events. Like when Fonica does those in-store events for DJs and artists when they drop an EP or whatever, or someone to do a little mix before they gig in the main club, there's a healthy amount of people that come out to them. It's not as if they're like empty. People turn out. So I wonder why there's not more of those spaces that kind of double up as a space where you can maybe live stream shows, like, you know, like on a radio station or whatever, and you can also do like, you know, signing events or whatever it may be. But who knows? But in the whole article is there for you to see. It's quite long. I won't read the whole thing. I'll put in the notes for you guys to check out yourself in the show notes descriptions. But it's titled Influencers Fees and the Future: How Will Dance Music Change as a Result of the Pandemic? It's on Ransom Note now, so check that out if you haven't already.